That's good. We're finally getting some people sitting in the front pew. I appreciate it. I'm worried. Yes, it's. Yeah, we are. We are in church, and my 2-hour sermon is about to begin. So I hope you all had a lot of chocolate. All right. Well, thanks for coming. My name's Jeff Thompson. I'm one of the intensive care pediatricians and the CEO of Gundersen. With me tonight, I have a couple other folks that are going to help, Dr. Mike Dolan and Kelly Barton. Both are vice presidents responsible for the behavioral health area. We have some video guests that are going to be a part of it. But the key to this whole piece is to really celebrate what a great day this is for patients in our communities. This is an outstanding movement forward in the health and well-being of our communities. My job as the CEO will be just to explain a little bit of the why. Why did we do this? Why now? Why in the midst of an economic downturn, the likes of which we haven't had for decades, why when we had a big project, you might have noticed this big project, already started. Why in the midst of that did we decide to launch this project? And it's pretty simple. The board, the senior management said, we need to ensure the best care for our friends and our families, for our neighbors, for our relatives, for our communities, for the employers in those communities. It doesn't happen by accident. We need to take on this responsibility. We can partner with the government. We can partner with the other agencies. We do that on a regular basis. But if we don't step up to this, we don't know who else will. In this country, every 16 seconds, someone commits suicide. Someone is in such a dark place, they commit suicide. That is all of our problems. That's why our board and our senior leadership said, we will take on these issues. J.R.R. Tolkien wrote, and now is famously in the movie, a line about someone giving another person light. And the line went, may it be a light for you in dark places, when all other lights go out. Might sound a little dramatic, but we believe we are that light. In this state, we have 72 counties. Over 50 of them have zero behavioral health beds. They are not addressing the problem. In the state of Wisconsin, in 1970, there were 13,000 inpatient behavioral health beds. There's less than 2,000 now. And yet we have 250,000 adults and children with serious mental health issues. So when others have downsized, or others have even gone out of the business completely, we chose to improve what we have. We chose to expand. We felt this is what taking care of our community looks like. Others said it was okay. It was okay to send adults or adolescents with severe problems at a time of crisis for the family, put them in a car, drive them to all other parts of the state or even into other states. Our board, our senior leadership, our community said this was not okay. We will be the light when there is no other options. So what do we build? Well, we build a space, we build a light. We felt that this is how you address the deep darkness of mental illness. Martin Luther King said, darkness doesn't combat darkness, only light combats darkness. We said we will take it on, but did we really build a building? What we really built was safety. We built support. we built Healing. Our staff, our amazing staff, who worked so hard on getting this organized. And our community partners, they cannot do it without some infrastructure, something to help them along the way. This will be that tool. This will help them accomplish these great things. Finally, you might ask, why did we put it here? Why did we put it in the midst of our campus? And in fact, many of my CEO friends think we're really quite out of line. They say, why now, in the midst of this economic problem? Why build at all? And if you're going to build, why on the campus? Why not build like many of them have done, out on the edges of town in a cornfield? So that if you decide at some point you don't want to do behavioral health, that's not something you're going to deal with. You can just cut it loose, make it someone else's problem. We don't believe that's an appropriate way to treat a patient, a family, or a community. This is the community building something for the well-being of the community. We believe that mental health is connected to all other issues. It's like diabetes or cancer or heart disease. We will take care of the patient as a whole. That is what this is about. That is why we have gathered together such a team to not only organize this, but lead it forward. Part of the leadership of that team is Dr. Mike Dolan and Kelly Barton. And I want to ask them to come up and give us their thoughts, as well as the video that I promised, about where we're going and why we're going down this journey. Thank you for your support, and thanks for helping us.
Thank you all for coming. 3 weeks ago, Kelly and I had the absolute privilege to say a few words at the Behavioral Health Staff Open House and Christmas Celebration in this facility. It was their first chance to actually get a look at the facility and the place where they were going to be working. And the following words that I'm going to speak were put together for them, and Kelly and I have been asked to share some of those, part of that message with you today. The first thing I want to do, though, is acknowledge that Kelly and I are fortunate to be on the end part of this behavioral health story as it enters this new chapter. But much of the credit for getting this project off the ground and making it come alive goes to the planning team and to our predecessors, Dr. Sig Three and Mary Jo Close. Without their involvement and without their tenacity, this project would not have been possible. So I want you all to thank them when you see them this weekend during some of these events, and thank them for being a part of this. I recently had the privilege to interview a psychiatrist who was applying to our medical staff. And as a medical vice president, we interview all medical staff that are trying to become physicians here. And he had just toured the new inpatient facility, and when I met with him that afternoon, I asked him, what do you think of our new facility? What are your thoughts there? And he said, when I was training in England, one of the things that I remember is that I saw a facility once in a small community, and I said to myself after I left it, this is the place where I want to practice. I want to be here because it was such a healing facility for people with mental illness, and it's where I would want to work in the future. But that afternoon, in response to my question, he said, I would have to say that your inpatient facility is my new standard. If we are lucky, each of us will get the opportunity to be part of something that is great and bright and wonderful. In this healing and hope-filled environment, we have the chance to move mental health care in our community forward in a huge and gigantic way. As we have seen most recently in Connecticut, mental illness touches everyone, rich or poor, black or white, and everything in between. This opportunity should make us feel excited and rejuvenated to be part of what the future of mental health care in our community means. But the care of our patients with mental illness is not about this building. It's a beautiful building. I would be the first to say it is fantastic. But it's not about a building. In order to take care of people, we need to actually do something more than just move into a building. I recently listened to a talk by a former Olympic athlete whose dreams were shattered when she was involved in a tragic accident as she was on a training ride. Cross-country skier, biking through the mountains of New Zealand, and 5 minutes from her destination, she was hit by a semi, paralyzed from the waist down, multiple injuries, and in the 18 months that followed, she became a pilot, a trainer, and a commercial pilot. And when she spoke, she was sitting in a chair, and at the end of her talk, she stood up and walked off the stage. But she said something that really struck me, and it really reminded me of what we need to keep track of when we move into this building. And the quote was a quote from the Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu. The quote goes something like this: "When you let go of what you are, you become what you might be." When I heard of this quote, I immediately thought of the behavioral health facility and the fact that we are standing at that juncture in time where we need to let go of what we were doing in our old facility and really learn to be something more than that. We need to become great, wonderful, and healing for the patients that use this space and share that journey with us. Jeff Thompson, myself, Kelly Barton, Ann Steckel, Dr. Ray Stewart, we cannot do that. This is going to be up to the employees and the staff that work in this facility. So that's my challenge to them. Let go of what you are and become what you might be. Become great and wonderful. During our staff open house, we actually had a very interesting event. We asked each of the employees to take a stone from a basket, to put an intention or a prayer into that stone, and then place it in the bottom of the glass waterfall in the meditation room. So when you go into that room tonight, which is a beautiful, beautiful space for families that have patients here, it's also meant for staff and anyone who feels the need to go in and meditate and maybe have prayer. I want you to look at those stones and know that each one of those was lovingly placed by a staff member here with some thought or intention for the patients that will be using our facility. I'd like to finish with a short story before I introduce the video that was written by a friend of mine, Gary Adamson. Gary read this to me in September, and at the time, although powerful, I didn't really know just how powerful it would impact me. As you listen to the messages in the story, and there are many of them in these short four pages, I would like for you to be thankful to the boards and the leadership of Gundersen Lutheran for making this great and bright and wonderful decision to build this facility. It's not an easy decision. Many people would call it the wrong decision, but for this community, it's the right decision. So the story is called The Great and Bright and Wonderful Decision by Gary Adamson. Once upon a time, and in a place not so far from here, a great and bright and wonderful decision was made, a decision that would change everything for years and years to come. Now, this decision was hard and difficult, so difficult, in fact, that most people thought anyone would be foolish to even consider it. It went against most everything that was being practiced in all the towns and in all the villages in all the parts of the countryside. To make matters worse, there was rumor spread far and wide with a certainty of fact that a great scarcity was coming and everyone needed to be prepared. So just at the time that some people were doing less, some of them much, much less, because they were scared of what it might bring, the great and bright and wonderful decision seemed very out of place. It seemed that this decision would require everyone to do more, to be more, to become more. Not now, not here, not ever was the reaction. Not when the rumored scarcity might come at some time in some place. The great and bright and wonderful decision was impossible. Except that it was not. In fact, it was quite easy, really. The first people to make the great and bright and wonderful decision knew something that everyone else already knew, although many had forgotten. You see, when the people were young, they thought almost every day that the story of their lives was destined to be great and bright and wonderful. They could do anything. They could become anything. There were 7 million wonders in the world, and all they had to do was choose one, and their very special life story would begin. But somewhere along the way, too many people got busy and distracted. They forgot about their great and bright and wonderful story, sometimes for just a day, but sometimes for a decade. And they talked about the great and bright and wonderful thing less and less because, even though many of them knew their story was more than half over, they didn't want the people who had forgotten altogether to make fun of them. One day, an old man named Peto and a young girl named Elise were sitting in a wild grass clearing by the rushing river. They had named this place the Laughing Spot. You see, the rushing river was really just a small stream with a big name, but what it lacked in size, it more than made up for in joy, especially at the laughter spot. Because here, as the stream got narrower, the water could run its fastest and bump into the big standstill stones and make a sound that reminded everyone of laughter. And the faster it ran, the louder it laughed, and it made everyone along the banks at the laughter spot smile, even if they were sad, because it reminded them of all they had in life to be happy about. Peto and Elise loved their time at the laughter spot. You see, even though Peto was very old, he was still young at heart, and even though Elise was young, she was wise beyond her years. So they would sit at the laughter spot for hours and hours and tell stories and ask questions and laugh. But sometimes they would cry, like the time Elise asked Peto, "Why do so many grown-ups seem a little sad, a little mad, and a whole lot tired?" Peto thought about the question, and it made him a little sad. "Elise, I think they just forgot," he said. "Forgot what?" she said. "They forgot that their lives are great and bright and wonderful," he replied. "Well, why don't you tell them?" she asked while pointing out the obvious. "I try to," Peto said gently. "And they remember for a while, but then they go back to their work and they forget again, and the more times they forget, the less they remember the next time until they don't remember at all. They think it is not possible that their life and their work are great and bright and wonderful. It is very sad." Peto sighed as a tear crawled down his face. Elise thought quietly about this for a long while because she didn't like seeing Peto so sad. And then, through her beginner's mind and through her child's heart, it came to her. "Peto, why is it that we are hardly ever sad or mad here at the laughter spot?" she asked. "How could we, Elise, when all around us are places of wonder and laughter and story and magic? There are many kinds of beauty in this place, and it tells us that there are many kinds of beauty in us," Peto replied. "Well, that's what we must do," she said. "We must build places of wonder and laughter and story and magic where people are working every day, and it will remind them every day that their work is great and bright and wonderful. And pretty soon it will remind them that they are great and bright and wonderful." And soon, that very day, at that very spot, Peto and Elise decided, and they gathered leaders and workers, architects and storytellers, designers and financiers to help them build these things they called story structures. And the more they built, the more people remembered that their life and their work were great and bright and wonderful. And the people did more and they became more because every day the place they worked reminded them of their story. And what happened to the rumored great scarcity? Did it come? Was it as terrible as everyone thought it would be? Well, the answer is that the great scarcity did come to many places, especially to those that were doing less and less because they were afraid. But when it came to the place full of story structures, it saw that scarcity hardly fit in the midst of all the abundance. And so it changed too. And they all lived happily ever after just because a small group of people made a great and bright and wonderful decision. Gundersen has made a great and bright and wonderful decision to invest in this community, in the care of our friends, our family, our neighbors, and our community. We're now going to show you a video featuring some of those that have been touched by mental illness. These people have been courageous enough to speak out and share their stories in order that we may be able to break and erase the stigma of mental illness and to help you understand exactly why this new space was created and what it means for our community. Thank you.
When I would look in the mirror, I saw nothing looking back at me. There was an emptiness inside of me, a deep sadness. It was a very dark world. That's very scary when you look at yourself and you don't recognize yourself. I didn't know your world could get that dark and that hopeless.
And I guess I never really thought I had depression. I just thought I was probably a mom that had gotten burnt out. So I took that person's advice and went to see a therapist, and I was diagnosed, of course, on the first visit with depression.
When my daughter passed away on November 19th, 2007, she was diagnosed with bipolar disease.
It is the most frustrating thing to have a loved one have a mental illness and want to be able to help them and rationally want to really just take over everything and care for them, but you can't. You can't do that. And what you have to do, unfortunately, is step back and hope the services are there to provide for that person.
My first experience with depression that I can remember is when my daughter graduated from high school. She had spent her 4 years of high school dealing with depression and anxiety. But I think the time I was the most afraid is when a teacher from the high school had called and said that she was suicidal and that my husband and I should come over and get her right away and take her to the hospital. And we did. We didn't end up in the La Crosse hospital though, because they didn't take teenagers at the hospital, so we had to go about a half hour away from here.
Everybody is touched in some way. It's amazing. I say you can't throw a stone without somebody having been touched by mental illness. It's kind of like when one of us started talking, more people started to come out and say, you know, my child has suffered from this disease. You know, I'm glad somebody is speaking up and making it known how prominent this disease is. And it doesn't affect just one person. It affects the entire family.
I think if people really knew the truth, there's not one person that won't be touched by it. And why I say that is because I guess the other big barrier here is stigma. People don't want people to know that their loved ones are on the psychiatric unit. They don't have that support out there when their loved ones on the psychiatric unit. People need to be comfortable talking about it. They need to be aware that, you know, there are families that are really struggling out there.
I think most people know there's a stigma, but it's one of those things where until it happens to you or a loved one, you don't realize how much. And people don't talk about it. It's one of those things. And I remember years and years ago, my mother was a nurse here for nearly 20 years at Gundersen Lutheran. And when cancer was being talked about, it was whispered, she has cancer. They used to whisper about that, and now everyone has a ribbon they wear, which, you know, that's wonderful. I'm looking for the day that we have a ribbon that everyone wears and says, you know, I have this and I'm living with it and life goes on.
If we can get to a new place of respect and dignity and a place where families can bring their loved ones in and not have to worry about not telling other people or other people finding out about it, I think that would be a great place to be.
I think there is still a stigma. But I think we've come a long ways, and really part of it is seeing this new behavioral health department open up and seeing the changes that our community is starting to make.
I think the biggest misconception is that, oh, they'll get over it, you know. It, if you're depressed, it's just no big deal, you know, it'll pass. Well, Gundersen is realizing that, you know, again, it's a physical illness and it needs to be addressed as such, and they want to address it with dignity and compassion.
And our current building is old. It's about 40 years old. It's not an environment that you would look at and call healing. And that's what we really, really want to create for our patients. They need hope when they come in. I think one of the key things is that we can have a facility that offers respect and dignity to our patients. That really helps decrease the stigma. I'm very proud of the investment that the organization has made.
It's been something that the people who suffer with mental illnesses have talked about for a long time, that they'd like to see change within the hospital systems. So I think it's really great that we're there now in La Crosse and that it's a recovery model. It's just so wonderful to know that people aren't going to be surrounded by walls and that they're going to have windows and they're going to have a courtyard and you know they're going to be able to be respected and treated, and it would decrease the amount of times they come back as well.
The expansion of the behavioral health unit here is something the community and surrounding area needs. I'm excited for the community that Gundersen Lutheran has decided to go forward with this and provide help for more people.
Behavioral health has always sat in the shadows, and I think I admire Gundersen Lutheran for taking those next steps, for listening to the community, for listening to the call of action that mental health is here in our region. Right? And we need to do more about it. And to actually make it part of the campus renewal, I give them a lot of applause for doing that.
I've talked with a lot of people from the hospital and the units over the last 4 or 5 years, and really just being able to hear from them and know that they deep down wanted to see change too. It's nice that we're all getting that wish that it's going to be better for everybody.
Good evening. For those of you that I have not had the pleasure of meeting yet, I am Kelly Barton, and I'm the Vice President for Team 4. Together with Dr. Dolan, we have the distinct pleasure of working with our behavioral health team here at Gundersen Lutheran. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Judy Schultz, Pam Bendel, Dr. Todd Marr, and Deb Marr for sharing their very personal stories with us tonight. And thank you, Tammy Anderson, for sharing your thoughts on how this new endeavor we are embarking on will greatly help our patients and our community. Vision Quest. A Vision Quest is a rite of passage in some Native American cultures. The ceremony of the Vision Quest is one of the most universal and ancient means to find spiritual guidance and purpose. A Vision Quest can provide deep understanding of one's life purpose. In fact, the Lakota Sioux word for Vision Quest is Hamblachia. The word Hamblachia translates to crying for a dream. Ladies and gentlemen, as you've heard, this new building is being unveiled to you this evening, will make a huge difference and impact the lives of thousands of people in our community every year in a very positive manner. While we are here to answer the call of so many of our fellow citizens that suffer from mental illness, we also are here to help the family members and loved ones of those individuals as well. Gundersen Lutheran is wholeheartedly committed to this vision and will be here for those that we serve. On behalf of Dr. Thompson, Dr. Dolan, and the entire Gundersen Lutheran family, I'd like to thank everyone who agrees with our vision at Gundersen Lutheran by donating resources to our campus renewal project. I'd like to especially thank those of you that have made gifts specifically for our behavioral health facility. We are truly grateful. As you can see, we have taken great strides at accomplishing what we set out to do a few years ago. While we begin seeing patients in the state-of-the-art facility on February 5th, Your space is not complete yet. Our vision is not complete yet. We still need your help. As the need for mental health care in the community grows, this building will continue to evolve and continue towards a completion. With your continued help and support, your gifts will help us meet the needs of our community sooner. The slide to the side of me gives you a website and a phone number to find out of all the ways that you can help us fulfill this vision. Please don't think of this as mere brick and mortar support, because it's not. This is about a healthcare organization in a community that understands mental illness, because they are not them, they are us. Because they are our children with an attention deficit disorder, which prevents him or her from learning, reaching his or her true potential. It's about the teenager who develops a disorder as a result of an altered body image. It's about the mother suffering from postpartum depression, unable to care for her newborn. It's the college sophomore who suffers from a break from reality. It's the businessman whose addiction steals from his family. It's the grandmother who has a new onset of confusion. It's the child with complex medical, social, and developmental issues who needs the support to have the highest possible quality of life. This is about those we know, about those we love, about those we want and need to help. This most certainly is about all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, this is our vision quest, our Heimblichia, our crying for a dream. With your continued support, we can fulfill it. Together, we can make a difference. I want to again thank each and every one of you who is here tonight. To those that have contributed, donated, and shared in this vision, thank you. To those of you that will contribute and donate, and those that will continue to do so, thank you. With your help, Gundersen Lutheran will continue to enjoy bringing hope and light to those in the community that truly need it. Thank you for being here tonight.
Very nice. Thank you, Mike and Kelly, and the folks that agreed to share their story on a video. Kelly pointed out that it's your program and your facility. Gundersen is owned and governed by the community. It's a community treasure. It is part of the community, and that's why the leadership of the boards and the organization felt it is our time. It is our time to take this on, not as something apart, but as a part of the whole. We believe it is our responsibility to do something great and bright and wonderful, to shine a light when there is no other light. That's our job. That's our promise to the community, and we're going to fulfill it. So thanks for your support. Our amazing staff and facilities and behavioral health who put this together, and our leadership who had the courage in the face of a lot of other pressures to say, this is what's best for the community. Thank you. Have a safe evening.